Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strawstown Rod and Gun Club.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Just Say Sports. My name is Rob Galtier. With me again this week, Chris Barto. Chris, welcome.
Thank you, Rob.
It's been a great couple weeks since we've last been on. Enjoyable.
A lot of good stuff in Philly.
A lot of good stuff in Philly.
Yeah.
Let's start with all the good stuff. Okay, moving on. Was there anything good?
Apparently, the Sixers did pretty well in the draft.
Well, some people think the Sixers did well in the draft. They managed to draft. They had five draft picks. They managed to draft two.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't completely screw up five draft picks. They only screwed up two of them, potentially. So maybe that's a good thing.
Yes.
The Phillies have been playing great.
Have they changed their win total since the last show? I'm not quite sure.
I don't even know that. I don't know the answer to that.
They might have one or two more, I think, in the course of the last 2 weeks.
Let me just pose this question to you. Has there ever been a more un-Philadelphia team that a Philadelphia fan base could relate to than this Phillies baseball team?
Not since last August.
Yeah. I mean, let's talk about the common denominators.
There's a lot of the same players, same manager.
Same manager, same general manager.
Yes.
But the good news is Klentak is ready to hold the course. We're going to stay the course. Because this is the same team he said that was dominant the first 2 weeks of the season. A juggernaut, he said.
Exactly. I heard the same interview on the way here today from this afternoon, and it's the same guys, so we have no problems.
Yep, same guys that were just in first place not too long ago, so there's no need to worry there. Let's face it, Gabe Kapler completely lost that team last year.
No doubt. He did. I agree.
No question. I mean, they got off to the good start. They overachieved. No question they overachieved. Mm-hmm. Got to give him some credit for that. But when they hit rock bottom, there was no turning it around.
They overachieved despite his managing. It could have been that much better. But when they went into the free fall, there was no stopping. Just like they've done the last seven games. They're not even competitive. They don't care. That's obvious. They don't hustle. They just had Chase Utley retirement night Friday. This is the exact antithesis of how he played the game.
You're right. It's a head scratcher to me that a professional sports team could be so unmotivated, so laissez-faire, so out of tune with their fan base.
It's a huge problem when you can tell when somebody hits the ball that may be a questionable play, they have to think to themselves to run hard. And that's what's happening on the field, which is just mind-boggling, like you said.
I think sometimes they hit the ball and hope to God it goes foul so they don't have to run hard. And that's just the feeling I get from this team. There is no, I don't even know how to put it into words. It's very rare that I'm speechless on this program, but the level of frustration of I struggle fast forwarding through Phillies games now. I mean, I can't even sit and fast forward through them, let alone sit and watch for 3 hours, 3.5 hours.
They've been unwatchable, so I can understand why you have that feeling. It's horrible. The game against Scherzer, where Segura didn't run again, is the tipping point where there needs to be major change in this organization from top to bottom. This isn't the blueprint Klentak put together in the offseason, that's for sure. And that game could have been completely different if Segura's on second with no outs mm-hmm. against Scherzer with his broken nose, who just happened to be a little motivated against the Phillies that night, unlike the Phillies against him.
Well, of course, the Phillies were without the Scherzer killer in Odubel.
That's right.
One guy who always hit Scherzer is Odubel Herrera. Now, Gabe said he's going to, after the double lack of hustle by Cesar, who you figured is closing in on free agency, might be interested or motivated to make a couple dollars along the way. However, he doesn't seem to be motivated to make that money. But Gabe has said that he is going to address it with authority. So that's my new motto, people. I'm addressing things with authority. So, Chris, I'd like you to trim that beard with authority. I just addressed it. We'll go to the phones now. Hello, welcome to Just Say Sports.
Hi.
Howdy, how are you?
To show you what faithful listener I am, I'm calling you from the middle of the Atlantic Ocean.
That is nice. I'd rather be there than here.
We just left Bar Harbor, and we're having dinner, but I wanted to give you guys a call and say, how about the Dodgers?
Is there still baseball season?
Three walk-off home runs in a row by three different rookies.
They are loaded. They are loaded.
I have written in my notes, the Dodgers and the Phillies are the complete opposite ends of the spectrum at this point.
What's happening to the Phillies?
There is just no enthusiasm whatsoever. There's nothing. There's nothing there. You watched them when they played the Dodgers. It was a complete, and we talked about it on the program, completely different worlds between this Phillies team and the Dodgers team. With all those great young players the Dodgers have, the pitching staff, oh my goodness. They aren't even in the same world with the Dodgers.
Yeah, I always thought one of the biggest weaknesses of the Phillies was their relief corps.
Yeah, it was, and they thought they addressed it during the season, or in the off season. But apparently, about nine injuries, took them out of it. But it's still no excuse for the way they play the game. And that's, you know what? There have been beloved Phillies teams who were 500 teams, but the way they played the game had people enjoying it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they would do anything to win a baseball game. This team will do anything to avoid sweating.
The disadvantage I have where I'm at is I can't see or hear you guys on your show, but I knew the number and I figured I'd give you a call.
Well, enjoy wherever you are. Have a great trip and call us when you get back. Thanks for the phone call. We have another caller on the line. We'll go back. Welcome to Just Say Sports. Hello.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I got you. I got you. What's going on?
Yeah, I can't hear you. I don't know what the connection.
Okay.
There we go.
Can you hear us now?
Now I got you.
All right, awesome. What do you got tonight?
I've got two things. One, Charlie Manuel, and the other one, Tom McCarthy.
Okay.
This lack of hustle is really nothing new to the Phillies over the last 10 to 12 years. Charlie McCarthy, no, Charlie Manuel
mm-hmm.
has had his problems with Jimmy Rollins and had to bench him. And that was significant because now Jimmy Rollins is an elder statesman of the Phillies. And the way he talks, you would swear to God he was Derek Jeter.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a good ball player, but he didn't hustle all the time.
No, he did not.
And then secondly, this is one of those Kodak moments. It could have been in Saturday's game when Tom McCarthy was talking to Ben Davis and Mike Schmidt about how the Marlins don't hit home runs. And he said the Marlins are dead last in all of baseball in home runs with only 57. They simply do not live by the long ball. They are not a long ball team. Bam! It goes out, what, 440 feet?
Yep.
And Mike Schmidt said, now what was that about the long ball? Yeah. And Tom McCarthy said, you mean about that they don't hit a lot of triples? And then it was back-to-back home runs.
Yeah, yeah. Well, how many times have we seen that this year?
Yeah.
Did
and
you?
And sadly, and then I'll get off, after they got shellumped by the Nats, the post-game people, and I think it was Michael Barkan, who I can't stand, but that's besides the point, said, well, at least the Marlins are coming to town, and it goes Marlins, Mets, Marlins, so the Phillies can start to fatten up their record again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They're doing a great job with it.
Yes, they are. It's all fat. Okay, thanks, fellas.
Thank you.
Take care.
Yeah, they're not fattening up anything. They're anorexic right now.
Did you like those two pop-ups at the end of the game on Saturday in the bottom of the ninth?
Yeah, it was...
Yeah, they were impressive. I wonder what the launch angle on those pop-ups was.
Well, and launch angle is important. That's what they're teaching them throughout the organization. So we're going to have an organization full of pop-up hitters.
Yep.
378-0426 is the phone number. If you want to call in and ruminate about this baseball team. Do you like that word?
Excellent.
I addressed both callers with authority. Did
yes.
I not?
You yes. did.
Okay, here's my theory on Gabe Kapler. Matt Klentak. Why Matt Klentak doesn't fire Gabe Kapler.
Okay.
The first person who always goes is the manager, correct?
Yes.
Second person that goes is who?
General manager.
General manager. If the first person doesn't go, then the second person is longer in that position. Am I correct?
You are correct and authoritative.
I address that with authority. Now, why fire Gabe Kapler when that's putting you next on the firing line? This is where John Middleton has to step up. He's been completely, you know, he couldn't wait to be in front of the camera to talk about the Bryce Harper signing.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a time where I think the owner needs to step out in front and say this is inexcusable. This is not the way baseball should be played. This will be addressed with authority because he is the ultimate guy.
Mm-hmm.
And if my manager's not going to do anything about it, I'm going to do something about it.
Yeah. He writes the checks.
I as someone who's in a position who has a lot of, you know, I work with a lot of employees and so forth, mm-hmm. I'm just dumbfounded that nothing is getting done. It's the same old things over and over and over again.
Not a darn thing has changed since our last show, except to get worse. Nothing has gotten better. Everything has gotten worse. And the authority isn't helping.
Now, just like 2 weeks ago, we both kind of gave them a grade of B minus.
Yes.
They were, right around first place.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I think we're in first place at the time by like a game.
Right.
They were hanging in there. There were a lot of injuries. You know, Andrew McCutchen went down, and they were still, Jay Bruce stepped up, and mm-hmm. they were hanging in there.
Sure.
Grade-wise now. For that same team. Because it's the same team. Matt Klentak tells me it's the same team.
Yeah. And
not dominated.
I think I told you the other day I would drop everyone one grade minimum. And the only way I would keep the team at a C minus is because they're still one game above 500 magically. But frankly, what you've seen on the field the last week is a flat out F.
Yeah. Would now... I think the only guy I wouldn't drop is Kingery.
Yeah.
But defensively, he can't play third base. But when you put the guy in how many different positions.
Right.
Okay. You've got a catcher. We all agree.
Mm-hmm.
You've got Kingery. You've got currently a second baseman who neither hits nor hustles. Why can't Kingery just play second base? Leave him there.
I don't know why he couldn't have stayed there from the time he put on a Philadelphia Phillies uniform. He played great there in his whole minor league career.
But now's the time. Now you send a message. Because apparently 2 weeks ago they sent the message to Michael Franco, you're no longer the third baseman. They haven't won a game since.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the few guys who actually, you know, can put the ball out of the yard. But I don't disagree with it. If they had a third baseman that was actually better than Michael, I'd really agree with it. But whatever. I'm not sure what. I mean, he isn't very good.
No.
But for him to have been the scapegoat originally when they were winning, and now they aren't winning. Okay. The thing that really topped this whole thing off for me is the two rainouts. Washington,
mm-hmm.
They showed high hopes. The 1993 legendary highlight video of that Phillies team who talked about how they would stay in the training room with Dutch for hours after the game, drinking beer, smoking cigarettes, and talking baseball, reliving the games, talking about how they can be better, talking about their opponents. They live, and they said by the end, half the team would be in there. Every night, talking baseball, and the way they play the game, Kruk constantly hustling, and Dutch constantly, Incaviglia running into walls.
They were a bunch of dirtbags, literally.
They were baseball players.
Who loved what they did for a living.
Go through that team and try to find one guy who didn't hustle. Mariano Duncan, Mickey Morandini, Kevin Stocker, Jim Eisenreich, Wes Chamberlain, Lenny Dykstra. These guys laid it on the line. Didn't matter if they started. Ricky Jordan, John Kruk. They laid it on the line. Todd Pratt, the backup catcher.
Mm-hmm.
They all had their moments where Danny Jackson as a starter, Terry Mulholland. These guys fought and fought and
Tommy
fought.
Tommy Green.
They fought, and it's just a. And then you come back the next night and you watch, and they watch this team, and they
get swept in a doubleheader.
I don't even feel better. I thought I'd feel better after tonight, but I don't feel better. Let's talk about Sixers draft. The Philadelphia 76ers picked up Matisse Thybul,
mm-hmm.
wing, guardish, small forwardish, University of Washington. Not much of a scorer in his career. Really struggled shooting his senior year. Did okay his first couple years, or mm-hmm. I mean last year, I should say. He really struggled with his shot. Interesting prospect, I think. They need defenders since they traded Covington. They need wing defenders. They need defenders who could guard point guards.
Right. I must admit, I never heard of him before the draft. But then I read about him that he was the National Defensive Player of the Year the last 2 years in a row. That says something for sure. And I've seen highlights of him now, and a great steal guy, a great block guy. I've heard he's smart, a good person, and someone that hopefully fits well in your organization. So time will tell, but it seems to have checked a couple boxes they needed.
Well, the big question is with Thybul, is he going to be able to score enough to help them? And he's come from a defense that the last couple years have played zone. And you watch a lot of his defensive highlights. He's obviously not guarding anyone. He's kind of watching the passing lanes, looking for opportunities. But he did remind me, he did remind me a lot of the way Kawhi Leonard played Ben Simmons. He wasn't really watching Simmons. He was watching, like, kind of knowing where Simmons was going to go.
Mm-hmm.
And Thybul really has great anticipation where he thinks a pass is going to go, where a dribbler is going to go.
Yeah.
And he's got lightning quick hands. So that certainly helps.
I did see that comparison to Kawhi Leonard with the serious asterisk of he's got a long way go to get anywhere close to that, but same type of player potentially. So, yeah.
And they drafted a defensive player too, a guard who's got a lot of potential, Zaire Smith, the previous year.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm actually, I do look forward to NBA Summer League, looking at all the rookies. Sixers are going to have an interesting team. They also... Christian Kamaji, the 7'4 center from Florida State, he's going to be a part of that team. And they're bringing Mario Shayok, who was their second-round pick. Zaire Smith is going to play. Shake Milton, who did great when he played with the Sixers in the NBA Development League. He's going to be on the team. So that'll be interesting to see that. But the big question with the Sixers now is the NBA free agency right around the corner on Sunday night.
Cannot wait.
First of all, Woj with a bomb saying that Kawhi would take a meeting with the Sixers.
I did not see that.
Wow. Yeah. Would people say he's just using the Sixers? He doesn't need to use the Sixers. Every team in the NBA is going to offer him the max. It's not like he's got to beg to get the max.
No, not at all.
So
it's a given.
Yeah. So Toronto's going to offer the max. The Clippers are going to obviously offer the max. There's no question about that. So if he takes a meeting with the Sixers, then there might be a legitimate interest. And if you're Kawhi Leonard, and you just played that seven-game series with the Sixers, which was obviously the toughest series they had, and you know that Embiid's going to be able to carry you the later part of your five-year contract.
I just had the thought, does he wear a wire to the meeting? Double agent.
Double agent.
Double free agent.
Double free agent. Tricky.
Hey, just throwing it out there. Never know.
Never know. Do you offer Jimmy Butler the 5 years?
Yes.
Do you offer Tobias Harris the 5 years?
No.
So you try to bring Jimmy back?
The only reason I wouldn't is for Tobias is because two maxes put him up against the salary cap with limited exceptions to re-sign your own free agents. And I think they could do better splitting up Tobias's 32 or so million a few ways. What do you think?
I'm torn. I see your way. I see a team that played 10 games together this year before the playoffs and took the eventual champions to seven games. Playing together 10 games.
Yeah. And they probably win the series in six if Embiid's healthy and not sick and whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, that doesn't mean they beat the Bucks. Doesn't mean they go on to beat Golden State. None of that. We're not making that leap. But Toronto was clearly the best team in the playoffs, and it was putting a ragtag team together at the end of the year, almost being able to beat them. I'm really curious to. So I have no qualms if Elton Brand brings them both back, and they say for the next 5 years we're going to ride this foursome and see what happens.
Yeah, I have no problem if they can do it and have some semblance of a decent bench. That's the part I'm not sure about.
Oh, that's where Matisse Thybul and Zaire Smith.
Do you know who hasn't slept in weeks?
Who hasn't slept
in weeks? The Golden State GM.
Oh, man.
Talk about somebody with their job cut out for him.
Yeah, but you know what? Probably the best thing that could have happened to him was Durant and Klay Thompson getting hurt.
Right, because they're expected to just rest and recuperate for the entire season.
You could just pay them the max now. You know, you have a down year. Everyone understands you're going to have a down year, but then you get both your guys back, which you didn't expect to begin with. So that certainly helps them. Women's World Cup, do they beat France in the semis? They squeak by Spain today?
Yeah, I think so. By a goal. How about you?
They weren't happy. The announcers weren't happy with the play of the ladies.
Yeah, it was coming out of pool play. Now they're in elimination mode, so they'll be fine.
Okay.
I know my U.S. soccer.
They gave up a goal. And Gary Woodland winning the U.S. Open. You said you really liked the prime time. You liked that 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock off.
I did. I thought it was must-see TV Saturday and Sunday. I've really enjoyed watching it. Rooting for Koepka and my fantasy team, but you got to give Woodland credit. He just did not crumble. Make that few bogeys on that course in that situation is phenomenal.
He didn't give in. Well, that takes it to the end of the program for us. We appreciate Straustown Rod and Gug Club for supporting BCTV and Just Say Sports. My name's Rob Galtier with Chris Barto. Good night, everyone.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strosstown Rod and Gun Club.